this, but here we go. You're recording. You're now recording.
Okay.
For a few minutes, I want to break down the skeletal system. A few disclaimers before we get started. Always study what your teacher wants you to study. And remember, for me, the reason that we highlight in the book is so that we can have an unbiased judge. We know what to study, and it's not something that I said here. It's what is highlighted in your book, and that way we all can know exactly what we need to study to do good on the test. This is just hopefully here to help tickle your brain a little bit, tickle your imagination, and get you ready for the test. Another beautiful thing that I love about the skeletal system is the fact that if you learn the bones of the skull, the frontal, the parietals, the temporals, the occipital, if you learn that, all of a sudden you have learned the major regions of the brain. If you learn femoral bone, then you know that the nerve that goes there is the femoral nerve. You know that the artery and the vein that go there are called the femoral artery and the femoral veins, respectively. And so it's a beautiful thing. This is kind of like setting the stage for so many elements in AMP 1 and 2. Also, to me, the bones are the number one element of AMP 1 lab, bone markings. It's not stuff that you and I talk about every day. And so that's why I try to do this really early, get started on the bones early. When I think about the skeleton, first I think about the axial skeleton, which is the head, the spine, the sacrum, the coccyx, and I think about the ribs wrapping around, connecting to the sternum. That's the axial skeleton. The appendicular skeleton, that is all the other stuff that hangs off of your body. You have a shoulder girdle with arms attached. You have a pelvic girdle with legs attached. So that would be appendicular. The appendicular skeleton would be the shoulders attaching the arms and the hips attaching the legs. Talking about a few markings in the skeletal system. A facet is a shallow area. Usually it's in an articulation. We see these in the spine. Along with processes, there are superior and inferior articular processes in the spine that allow for these facets to articulate one with the other. A fossa is an indentation. The specific one that I think of is the glenoid fossa. This is where the head of the humerus articulates with the shoulder. There is a fovea, the fovea capitis is a small indentation in the head of the femur that allows the femur to articulate, or actually to attach with a ligament to the acetabulum of the pelvis. Grooves, the one that I think about is the intertubercular groove, which is one of the sites for the bicep tendon tracking in the upper origin area. Down at the end is the insertion, which is the radial tuberosity. If we have a narrow tube, it's called a meatus. Sometimes it might be called a canal, but when I think about this, I think of the external auditory meatus. I think about the canal that leads to the eardrum. A fissure is a narrow feature in a bone. Condyles are typically big articular features. I'm thinking about the distal end of the femur and how it articulates with the tibial plateau. Tibial plateau has a nice meniscus around it that allows for the femur condyles to articulate. A crest is a narrow, long projection. I'm specifically thinking about the iliac crest. If I say put your hands on your hips, you're going to put your hands on the iliac crest of both hips. The head is usually an articular surface on a bone. A tubercle or a tuberosity is, in the big picture of a projection, kind of a smaller one. So let's go in order of largeness, possibly. A process might be next, a protuberance, and then a trochanter. The large trochanters on the femur are what allow for internal and external rotation of the leg. Remember that a line is an elevated feature on a bone. On the femur, it is the attachment site for a muscle, large muscle. In the vertebrae, the thoracic spine has thorny downward projections. The cervical spine and the lumbars, oftentimes the spinous process is just project directly backward or posteriorward. Epicondyle means above. If the condyles are the articular surfaces at the end of the femur, then the epicondyles are the areas right above there, usually muscle attachment sites. On the humerus, there is a greater and a lesser tubercle, and in between these tubercles, there is an intertubercular groove. Once again, that's one of the bicep tendons tracks right through there. In the skull, there are four major bones. We talk about the frontal, parietal, temporal, and occipital. Remember, between the frontal and the parietal bones, that is where the coronal suture is located. Between the parietal bones is the mid-sagittal suture. Around the temporal bone is the squamosal suture. And then in the back, the occipital bone is separated from the parietals by the lambdoidal suture. It does kind of extend forward, and it's named a little bit different whenever this suture line goes behind the mastoid, but I'm not getting into that so much right at the moment. One of the major features in the occipital bone is this big hole right here. What do you call this one where the spinal cord exits? Say it out loud. It's called the foramen magnum. In the temporal bone, we have the ear hole. What is this called? The external what? Auditory meatus. Also remember, behind the ears we have the mastoids, and then there is a styloid process. I drew a line from the styloid down to the hyoid in the neck, because there is a muscle that attaches from the styloid in the head down to the hyoid in the neck, aids in swallowing and pharyngeal movements. I think I misspelled that one a minute ago. If we look down into the skull, there is a big bat wing bone called the sphenoid bone. It can also be seen on the sides of the skull and actually inside of the orbits, kind of on the lateral sides. This is called the sphenoid bone. And the main feature inside the skull is the sella turcica. This is where the pituitary gland sits. The foramen ovales are also inside of the sphenoid bone. They're kind of spaced rather far apart on the bottom side and on the inside of the skull. You can see both of these. In the middle front, there is the ethmoid bone. The crista galli is a sticking up part where the fox cerebri attaches, and this kind of helps to separate the separates the cerebri and keeps them a little bit from knocking around in the head. The cribriform plates are on either side of the crista galli, and this allows for olfactory receptors to go up into the skull so that the olfactory nerves can carry the sense of odor back to the brain for interpretation. Remember that the ethmoid also has a perpendicular plate that goes straight down, and it meets with the vomer on the bottom to create that middle plate that separates one part of your nasal cavity from the other. There are paired nasal bones. There are lacrimal bones inside of the medial aspect of the eye. The zygomatic bones are your cheek bones. And know this, that the palate or the roof of your mouth has palatine bones at the back, but the front part of the palate is made of the palatine process from the maxillary bones, the face bones in your body. When we think about the mandible, there is a foramen in the very front. It does conduct the inferior alveolar nerve and blood vessel. There is a hooking up process called the coronoid process. And remember, there is a condyle on the end of the mandible that articulates with the temporal bone to make the only freely movable joint in the skull, according to your book, which is called what? The TMJ. Temporomandibular joint, TMJ. Everybody say TMJ.
TMJ.
Very good. Very good. Let's review one more thing here. I thought this was kind of interesting. But the maxillary sinuses, look up in here, And then the ethmoid sinus is in the middle. They both drain into the nasal cavity, and they drain right above the inferior nasal conchae, or the inferior turbinates between the middle and the inferiors. I looked this up, learned that the nasal conchae, especially the inferior nasal conchae, help to humidify the air and create turbulence to kind of slow down air passage through your nose. That's so that the hairs and the mucus can have a better opportunity to trap things that won't have the opportunity to get down in your lungs to be coughed up later. May not be the only reason, but it kind of makes sense to me. That seems rather intuitive. Remember that on a baby's skull, there are fontanelles. The skull bones are developed in intramembranous tissue, and these fontanelles allow the baby's head to model or remodel as the baby travels through the birth canal. They actually might overlap one over the other as the baby is moving out of the woman's body. And then after the baby emerges, these can move back into their original position. Some people have said that this possibly might stimulate the brain stem for breathing in the newborn, possibly. Remember that the only non-articular bone in the whole entire body is the hyoid bone. It does function in swallowing and in pharyngeal processes. We learn a couple of differences in the male and female skeletal system. Learned that oftentimes the male forehead is sloped backward more than in the female, and also that the pubic angle in the male is more acute and in the female is more obtuse. Remember this, there are some males that might have a more female pelvis. There are some ladies that have little tiny hips. That's possible, there's variation. And that's why whenever I'm talking to you and I'm telling you about anatomy, mostly what I say is true. You know, at least probably 80% is true. Some of it might be variable. It's possible. Think about that. Talking about the spine, there are 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracics, 5 lumbars. There's a sacrum that has about 5 fused bones in it, and a coccyx, 3 to 5 fused bones. Remember that the thoracics have their spinuses pointing downward. The cervical and the lumbar vertebrae, the spinuses project almost directly backward. Another interesting thing that we learned about the lumbar spine is that the spinal cord ends L1, L2, L3, and then it just from that point forms what's called the cauda equina, just nerve roots that extend downward from there. Quite well arranged, might I add. Let's talk about the sacrum one more time before we head back up to the cervicals. The body of the sacrum is the part that supports the weight of the 5th lumbar vertebra. There is a sacral promontory that projects out from there. There is a median sacral crest, which basically is the fusion of the spinuses, those different bones that were fused together to make the sacrum. There are sacral foramina, which allow for nerves to exit into the hip area. The sacral hiatus is just the terminus of the sacral canal, and from there would project the coccyx. Let's go back up just for a minute and let's talk about the cervicals, because I was just about to skip past those. Remember that all cervical vertebrae have a transverse foramina. Why do they have a transverse foramina? Why do they have a hole in the transverse process? Everybody look up. Why is it? What goes through those? The vertebral arteries. This is the blood supply to the brain. We also have the carotids, which do this, but in this case, the transverse foramina provide kind of a flexible bony tube for some of the blood supply to go to the brain. Kind of interesting. I want to talk specifically about the C1 and the C2 vertebrae. The atlas has 2 lateral masses, people. It doesn't have 1 central body. And the reason that that's important is that the lateral masses of the atlas articulate with the occipital condyles of the occiput, and look up, allows for this kind of motion. Yes. Whereas the axis has a sticking up part around which the atlas rotates. So a lot of the rotation that you have in your neck is atlantoaxial. Let's talk about this little drawing that I did right here, and let's talk about the discs between the vertebrae in your backbone. When a vertebrae misaligns posteriorward, it's easy to see how that the nucleus pulposus, this little centerpiece, can kind of get squirted out forward, puts pressure on the annulus fibrosus in the front and in the back. Remember that the nerve exits in the intervertebral foramina between these two bones, so whatever this nerve is supplying is not going to be happy. As chiropractors, we move the vertebrae back onto the vertebra below it, or we attempt to do that. And as we do that, we hope that the nucleus pulposus can become more centered and thus take pressure off this annulus fibrosus and minimize inflammation around this nerve root, hoping that whatever this nerve root supplies is going to be happier. If it goes to a muscle, that muscle might be in less spasm after this proper appositioning takes place. Remember, it takes time to heal. It's kind of like slamming your thumb in the car door. Just because you open the door and remove your thumb from the car door doesn't mean that your thumb stops hurting right then. It takes time. Remember that. Let's talk about the rib cage for just a few minutes. The midline is the sternum, the top is the manubrium, and I haven't really emphasized this a lot, but the clavicle that goes to your shoulder articulates with the manubrium. And the body is the middle portion. The xiphoid sticks down right here. I was noticing recently that when we do chest compressions on somebody in CPR, it's important not to break off this xiphoid. It's important to be up higher so that the chest compressions don't damage the xiphoid. That's kind of a practical clinical thing that we need to consider. One of the things that I also learned is that there are true ribs and there are false ribs. The first seven pair are true ribs. Why are they called true ribs? Because these ribs go directly back to the sternum through cartilage. The lower ribs are called the false ribs, and the last two pair, because they don't articulate back to the sternum at all, even indirectly, are called floaters. So these on T11 and in T12, these will be called floaters. 8 through 10 are called false ribs because they do connect back to the sternum, but rather indirectly through cartilage. Remember, the clavicle is called the collarbone. This is, some people kind of even act as if it's a brace or a support to just keep the arm away from the body. Remember, the scapula in the back, the clavicle in the front, that's what attaches your whole arm to your body. You have lots of muscles that attach your shoulder. So therefore, if there's a shoulder problem, a lot of times it takes muscle rehab to get this better. And of course, surgical repair if there's damage to cartilage or muscle. When we talk about the scapula, the spine of the scapula is what leads into the acromion. The articulation of the acromion to the clavicle is called the AC joint. Remember that there is another process coming off the front. Look up, it's right about in here. It's called the coracoid process. It means coraco, beak, and it's one of the origins of the bicep muscle. Remember, it's called bi because it has two heads to it. One of them tracks in the intertubercular groove on the humerus. The other one comes off the coracoid. And then the glenoid fossa is the little shallow indentation on the side of the scapula where the humerus articulates. That's called the glenoid fossa, which leads us to the next bone, the humerus. The head is the articular surface covered with hyaline cartilage. There is a greater and a lesser tubercle and an intertubercular intertubercular groove. So one of the heads of the bicep muscle goes between these, this greater and lesser tubercle. Remember, on the distal end of the humerus is the trochlea. Why is this important? Because there's a trochlear notch on the ulna that allows the humero-ulnar joint to act as a hinge joint. Kind of like this. The capitulum, or the marble-sized, it's like a shooter marble size, is what articulates with the radial head. Look up. This is what allows for supination and pronation of the forearm. It's actually a joint between the ulna and the radius that allows for that, but the head also articulates with the capitulum on the humerus. We know that as well. Remember that down on the end of the humerus, right above the trochlea and right above the capitulum, are the epicondyles. You can have tennis elbow, golfer's elbow. There are muscle attachment sites on these epicondyles. On the ulna and the radius, remember that they both have styloid or pin-like processes on the distal end, down near the wrist. Remember that. Also, on the radius, there is a radial tuberosity, which is the site of one of the insertion areas for the biceps tendon. Let's talk about the hand. And right now, I'm looking at the back of the right hand, and I'm going to be listing left to right. And we're going to do the distal row of bones first. So say these after me. Trapezium.
Trapezium.
Trapezoid.
Trapezoid.
Capitate.
Capitate.
Hamate.
Hamate.
Okay, the proximal row. Scaphoid.
Scaphoid.
Lunate.
Lunate.
Triquetrum.
Triquetrum.
Pisiform. The long bones in the hand are called the metacarpals. Remember that the phalanges have a proximal, middle, and a distal phalanx. And what is the science word for thumb?
Pollex.
And it has only a proximal and a distal phalanx. When we talk about the hips, if I tell you to put your hands on your hips like this, basically you are putting your hips on the crest of the ilia. Remember, out front, there is a prominent feature called the ASIS. Everybody say anterior superior iliac spine. Say that.
Anterior superior iliac spine.
Okay. We know that the sartorius muscle attaches or inserts there, originates there, and it inserts down onto the tibia and allows for you to cross your leg like this. There is a posterior superior iliac spine. Everybody say PSIS.
PSIS.
Okay, sometimes it's good to keep it simple. Remember that the hips are made from three separate bones that fuse inside the acetabular cavity, the ilia, the ischia, and the pubis, ilium, ischium, pubis. Remember that one big feature that the ischia and the pubis bones make up is the obturator on either side. That is a paired structure. The acetabulum is a paired structure. Remember that acetabulum is what wears out, the cartilage wears out, and that leads to a hip replacement sometimes. Now let's talk about that for just a minute. Let's talk about a clinical aspect. If a hip replacement is performed, look up, the femur will be cut off on the surgical neck, and there will be possibly a titanium prosthesis that gets hammered down into the femur, and then this gets reattached into possibly a titanium socket anchored into the hip bone. There is a difference between the surgical neck and the anatomical neck. The anatomical neck of the femur is right below the head. Now, before I go any further, because I will likely forget this, the femur is the longest bone in the body. But what about the littlest, tiniest bones in the body? What about the malleus, incus, and the stapes? Those are really tiny bones. Where are those found?
Here.
They're found in the middle ear, right? And so we know that the malleus is attached to the eardrum, and then the stapes or stirrup is attached over to the oval window, and this is what helps translate vibrational sounds so that you can have the sense of what? Everybody say sense of hearing. Sure, that's it. Very good. We haven't really talked about that at all, but that's one thing that I don't want to skip or leave out. Remember that in the femur head, there's a little fovea capitis, and there's a ligament that attaches the femur head over to the acetabular cavity and helps to anchor the hip bone. The greater and lesser trochanters are found on the proximal part of the femur, and they help in thigh rotation, inward and outward specifically, they do that. On the distal end, there is a medial, and then there is a lateral condyle. And a lot of times, It's the medial condyle that takes, on this side, this would be medial. It's the medial condyle that takes the brunt of the force, and I've even heard of some surgery reconstructions of the knee that only resurface the medial aspect of the knee. That's kind of interesting, instead of an entire knee replacement. The patella is a shield-shaped bone with the apex pointing down. Remember, the patella receives the quadriceps tendon and then attaches onto the tibial tuberosity so that a person can get extension of the leg. The top part of the tibia that articulates with the condyles on the femur is called, I call it the tibial plateau. It's built up with a nice meniscal cartilaginous labrum to provide a nice tracking area for the condyles. Listen to me. Remember that the knee is just meant to go front to back. It's not meant, your foot is not meant to go in and out, and your leg is not meant to go from side to side. When you start trying to do those, especially if it's a repetitive motion, the knee is going to suffer. Just know that. That's going to happen. The medial malleolus is the medial aspect of the distal tibia that creates the inside ankle bone. The fibula, or the distal end of the fibula, which is on the side out here, is what creates the lateral malleolus, creates the outside ankle. Let's talk about the foot lastly here. The bone in the foot that articulates with the distal end of the tibia is called the talus. Everybody say talus. Heel bone is calcaneus. Everybody say calcaneus. There is a large chunky bone on the outside of your foot called the cuboid that can get displaced upward, especially if you're climbing a ladder and you're carrying a big old ream of shingles, 60-pound shingles up a ladder. There are cuneiforms. Everybody say this, medial, middle, and lateral. Everybody say first, second, and third. Those are a couple of different ways that you can define the cuneiforms, and they're kind of at the base of the first, second, third metatarsal area. A key element of the medial longitudinal arch of the foot is the navicular bone. This bone is located between the talus and the cuneiforms. The cuneiforms can be called first, second, and third, medial, middle, and lateral, or medial, intermediate, and lateral. They lie just proximal to the metatarsal heads in each foot. Metatarsals are the long bones in the foot. The phalanges are your toes. The big toe is called the what?
Pollux.
Not the pollux, which is the thumb. Also, here's what I wanted you to remember. The main arch in the foot is that medial arch on the inside of your foot. And if that arch drops when your foot hits the ground, we have learned that the knee buckles inward and it basically creates a functional short leg. And so the pelvis tilts downward on that same side and can create low back pain, which then can reflect problems into the thoracic and the cervical area. So what I say about this is when somebody has a medial longitudinal foot problem and they might need an orthotic, I say that they're toe up from the flow up, because the problem in their foot can cause problems up the entire spine. And here's what I see too. As a chiropractor, when people come into my office and they have low back pain misery and I can see the misery in their face, sometimes that's when people need a checkup from the neck up. Right? Because sometimes chronic pain can cause even hopelessness. We don't want that. We don't want people to feel hopeless. We want to be able to find the source of the problem. And with some of the anatomy that we know, sometimes it might just be a simple orthotic that can help create a structural problem that's causing problems all the way up the entire spine of a person. And then they can have a smile on their face, maybe. That's a good plan, right? So that is my review of the skeletal system. Do good.